What if you go? What if you stay? I love you. What if you're cruel? You can be kind. I know.
From the news center outside the city of Chicago in the great Midwest, it's the Stranger Than Fiction News right here on The Fringe FM. I'm Vance Nesbitt. Here's our headlines. Laura Dern, Jeff Goldblum, and Sam Neill are back together again for Jurassic World 3. Jurassic Park movie fans have something to roar excitedly about like a T-Rex. All three original Jurassic Park main cast members, Laura Dern, Sam Neill, and Jeff Goldblum, will return for the first time together in Jurassic World 3. Director Colin Trevorrow revealed the news at a special screening of Jurassic World in Hollywood last Tuesday. Dern confirmed her participation in Jurassic World 3, as well as the return of Neill and Goldblum, at the same screening, according to Deadline.com. Last Wednesday, Jeff Goldblum posted his excitement to Instagram about returning to the Jurassic film franchise again as Dr. Malcolm. Quote, "Happy as a Climasaurus to be reunited with my brilliant co-stars from the original Jurassic Park, Laura Dern and Sam Neill, for the next installment of Jurassic World." Trevorrow told the audience the three actors were not only reprising their original roles, but they would all have major roles and not merely cameos alongside Chris Pratt. Dern, Neill, and Goldblum first appeared together back in 1993's hit Jurassic Park that started the popular dinosaur movie franchise. Source, CNET.com. And an ATV rider comes upon an unidentified bipedal creature. A Clark County, Idaho man says he was riding his ATV when he came across a primate-like creature. The anonymous man says he was camping with a friend when he witnessed the odd animal back in July of 2007. Quote, "As we rode down the trail, I stayed about 50 yards behind my friend. It was getting dark enough that the headlights of our ATVs were illuminating the trail and passing trees, but still enough light in the sky so you could look around and see hillsides and clearings," he told the BFRO. At some point, he recalls there was something that he thought was a tree stump, but it suddenly stood up. Quote, "At first, this thing was facing away from me and watching my friend, who was ahead of me. As I started going by, I leaned away from it to my right. It looked over towards me over its right shoulder, and then it appeared to straighten out its right arms towards me." The eyewitness described it as an 8-foot-tall humanoid with dark hair all over its body. Its face, however, showed dark skin and yellowish eyes. Its hands were similar to humans with fingers and a thumb. He also claims there was a particular smell that resembled that of an elk in rut. Source, CryptozoologyNews.com. And time for the infamous Stranger Than Fiction Fringe Fun Fact. The famed Typhoid Mary infected more than 50 people by cooking for them. Typhoid Mary was a real historical person who became notorious in the early 1900s. She insisted on working as a cook during her career. She infected at least 51 people, three of whom died before she was isolated and enforced quarantine for the last decades of her life. This has been the Stranger Than Fiction News on The Fringe FM. Again, I'm Vance Nesbitt, news anchor and sorcerer.
Message is being broadcast by the Department of Defense of the Republic. At 2 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, multiple unidentified objects were confirmed to have entered Earth's atmosphere.
Discovery Houston, 20 seconds to LOS egress.
The first message that comes to you is you are a divine being. You matter. You count. You come from realms of unimaginable power and light, and you will return to those realms.
The vast stretches of the unknown and the unanswered and the unfinished still far outstrip our collective comprehension.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Broadcasting from Forest Tower Studios, all the way from the Deep South. Now, here is your host, Joe Root.
Broadcasting from atop a hill on the mossy creek bottoms of Cane Creek, Arkansas, I'm Joe Roop, and this is Lighting the Void. We're live on KTLK Digital Broadcasting. It's October 4th tonight where we are, and we're heading on into the 5th. And this is the weekend we're going to be at the Expo, so I got to tell you right off the bat, just so you know, this is the climax of the broadcast this week, because we have author, lecturer, practicing magician, Dr. Stephen Skinner is with us, and this is going to be a very interesting conversation. Now, we've had magicians on this broadcast many times, several very good magicians, hermeticists, but they all of them know who Dr. Stephen Skinner is, and he's very popular among ceremonial magicians and magical practitioners, and I suggest that you, if you're into magic, turn your ears up tonight, because you're probably going to learn quite a bit. This show is brought to you by GetTheTea.com. Make sure you go get the tea and keep yourself cleansed. Prepare yourself to guard yourself from those intruders, and also Ancient Life Oil, the best CBD oil on the planet, and PrepareWithTheFringe.com. I really hope that you guys do come out this weekend. Tomorrow night we're going to have, if you're in the area when we're at the expo, tomorrow night we're going to just do a best of. Because I'll be at the conference, and after that, we'll kick it back up the way it was normally done. And now, if you haven't noticed, I spent all night. I'm going on no sleep right now. I think I'm into my second day. So I spent all night. For all of you that have been hitting me up with emails for the archives, they're caught up. They're all there. So, you know, if you want to binge, go for it. You can support the show by donating. If you go to the website, lightingthevoid.com, there's a donate button at the bottom. You can also grab some swag. Hats, shirts, all that good stuff. And if you, most of you know this already, but if you're into ufology, there's only one people to follow. That's UFO Seekers. Give them a follow on Twitter to stay in the conversation. Check out their best work on youtube.com/UFO Seekers. Backed and supported by the Fringe FM. If you've had a sighting you cannot explain, give them a call at 661-UFO-7889. If you want to get into the chat, I figured out that the fringe.fm/chat, that's what's wrong. It wasn't working. So if you go to the website, the network website, the fringe.fm, if you hit the chat button up there, it'll take you right to it. And you'll go to the welcome page with the rules, and then that's it. All you got to do is go to the main hall and just have fun. Now let's kick this off, okay? This is a big deal to me, because to me, as somebody that's into magic and the occult, and I'm going to drop the Amazon, I'm going to drop all these links in the chat room so you guys can check this stuff out for your reference. But to me, we're going to be sitting at the foot of a Buddha tonight, in my opinion. Okay, that's just my opinion. And I think that you'll probably feel the same if you're into magic before this is all over with tonight. But Dr. Stephen Skinner began his career as a geography lecturer and magazine publisher, but his long-term interests have always been magic, Western magic, specifically in Feng Shui. And during the 1970s, he was a driving force behind Askin Publishers, producing a number of classical magical works by Cornelius Agrippa, Paracelsus, Osman Spare, Aleister Crowley, and others. And during the 70s, he co-wrote many books with Francis King, including the still popular Techniques of High Magic. And also with Francis King, he wrote Nostradamus. His interest in prophecy, stimulated by this book, he went on to write the best-selling Millennium Prophecies. He's also credited with bringing the art of Feng Shui to the West, and in 1976, he wrote the Living Earth Manual of Feng Shui, which was the first English book on Feng Shui in the 20th century. So we're talking to the man that's pretty much responsible for bringing Feng Shui into the West the way it is now. Stephen has written more than 55 books, which have been published worldwide in 28 different languages, and these books have introductions by such diverse people as Colin Wilson, HRH Charles Prince of Wales, and Jimmy Choo, shoe designer to the stars. Now, Stephen lives in Singapore, and he's the first Westerner to be awarded with the title of Grand Master of Feng Shui by the International Feng Shui Association, and to me, most well-known for translating the Greek magical papyri all the way through and properly. Better than anybody. And thank you so much, Dr. Skinner, for coming on the program. It's a real treat having you.
Oh, it's a pleasure to be here, and thank you for that very nice introduction.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm sure there's so much more that I could say about you. I mean, I'm dropping the Amazon links and all the website links into the chat room to show people just all of the work that you've done. I mean, you've put your life into this, and if anybody knows, like, the basic stuff, like the biggest questions about magic, I would think that you would be one of the go-to people for this, right?
I've spent a long time trying to get to the bottom of things like magic and feng shui. They're quite separate, but they're both equally mysterious and not very well known.
Yeah, and I think, you know what else I think, too, is what a lot of people want to know. And I've asked Gordon White this too, and I'll ask you. What I think what people want to know is, we've talked about this a million times. Like, how does magic work? What is going on? And I've always tried to tell them. I'm like, look, you know, we've given them the Aleister Crowley definition of magic. We've talked about how it just seems to work like a coincidence sometimes when it comes to manifestation. And then certain laws of the subconscious that you got to follow to get things to happen. But I mean, this is basic stuff, and I think if I wanted to start this conversation off, I think I would ask you, what is the one thing that you think that most people do when they fail, when they do a magical operation, when they try to manifest something, or they try to do any operations, crying doesn't matter, and they fail? What do you think is holding them back?
Well, I think what's holding them back is the idea that it's all in the head. It isn't all in the head. You can't manifest things simply by visualizing them or wishing they were there or asking them to arrive. That sort of thing can help psychologically so that you work better or you work harder, but it's not magic. My definition of magic is that magic only works through spirits or daemons. We, as human beings, we can't do magical things. We can do pretty spectacular things, but not the things that most people think of as magic. And the way to get those things to work consistently is to work with spirits, specific spirits that do specific things, and compel them to do those things for you. And then you can consistently get magical results. Now, this will make me very unpopular with a lot of people who either take Crowley's definition that it's just willpower, or Dan Fortune's definition, and so on. Obviously, willing something very strongly is very good psychology and will help things work through in your life. But if you want a fairly instantaneous, literally magical result, then you've got to go to entities who have abilities beyond and above anything that humans can do.
Now, an obvious question I think everybody's thinking now, well, wow, Dr. Skinner, how dangerous is that? Is it dangerous, you know, to pick up a grimoire and just start performing an operation?
Yeah, it's dangerous to do something without the proper precautions. It's dangerous to pick up a chemistry set and mix up calcium chlorate and sulfur and put a match to it. Anything that has a serious result, it's dangerous to drive a car without learning how. Anything that has a serious outside world result, you need to understand how to do it and do it with the right precautions. And the same is true of magic. People who say, oh, we can sit in our armchair and visualize a circle on the floor and just call the spirits, they're either kidding themselves or putting themselves in a dangerous position. Now, the church has been saying for almost 2,000 years that magic is dangerous and puts your soul in peril and things like that, because the church doesn't want people to do it. The church wants to be solely the arbiter of miracles and things. Magicians have long known that you can do it by simply calling the right spirit, binding them, ordering them what to do. But you've got to take the precautions. And then the next obvious question is, what are the precautions? You've got to draw a consecrated circle on the floor, which will protect you from the spirit. You've got to wear a phylactery. And then you've got to call them in the right way. When they come, instead of just saying, oh my God, that's spirit manifesting in front of me, you have to bind them to make sure that they will do what you say. Now, I can't give the details of how you do all that on a radio show.
Sure.
But it is a technology. What is a technology? A technology is something that has a message that can be repeated again and again. It's like my father-in-law's a chemist, a professor of chemistry. And even he says, with chemical reactions, it will work exactly as the book says, 9 times out of 10. And on the 10th time, something like an impurity or a different change of temperature will interfere and it won't work. Well, that's roughly the scorecard on magic done properly. As long as you do it properly, you take the right precautions, and you don't try and cut corners, then it will work most times.
When you manifest a spirit, do they come into your vision? Or how do you know that they're there? Does the operation let you know how you know they're going to be there?
That's a good question. To get a spirit to manifest visibly, and I have done that on a number of occasions, is very hard work. But you can get it to manifest in a way by producing effects. Like, for example, if you've effectively called a spirit and it hasn't manifested, but the temperature drops 5 or 10 degrees, you know it's arrived. Or if the incense smoke flutters in a strange way, you know it's arrived. On one occasion, I called a spirit whose form is a bird-headed creature. And it didn't arrive, but at the point which I knew it had arrived, a whole flock of birds flew down the chimney, flew around the room, and flew out again. Now I thought, okay, I must be having hallucinations. But in the morning, when I went to clear up, there was bird shit on the floor. But the bird shit was only outside the circle. There was no bird shit inside the circle.
Wow.
Which was the day I finally got convinced that, yes, a properly consecrated circle does protect you from spirits. So if you do it right, that's good. But of course, it takes a lot of work to actually get to do it right. And it also takes a lot of work to find out what is right, because there's all sorts of people writing all sorts of things. My go-to is to go to the books written by magicians who actually practiced. And these books are called Grimoires. It's a waste of time reading what the church says about magic, or even, I hate to say this, even what most academics say about magic, because it's theory only. It's like the chemistry professor talking about this, that, or the other without having ever picked up a test tube. You can't do it. You've got to actually do the operations. So anyway, that's
so
my,
when you interpret a grimoire, and some of these grimoires are written by different magicians, all doing the same operations. Is that right? Like, you may pick up a book by one magician doing, I don't know, and I'm just throwing things out there, like the black pullet or whatever, and then you may pick up another magician that's doing the same thing, and then do you read both and then decide, okay, I need to figure out what's best. What's the best operation here?
Well, mostly I don't read books. I read manuscripts, the okay. things actually written by the magicians themselves. And a lot of my time is taken in reading these, translating them out of French or out of Latin, or I wish I could translate German, but I can't, and then publishing them in English. So because the grimoire is a sort of notebook by a particular magician, it he only writes down the things he needs to remember on paper. So inevitably, he will leave out the things that he takes for granted, like some will take out the dismissal ritual at the end, which is key. Once you have called a spirit, told it what it wants to do, what you want it to do, you have to dismiss it. You can't leave it hanging around. It will cause all sorts of problems later. So some of these grimoires will leave out key pieces. And I don't think it's deliberate. I don't think it's the old magical blind trick. Mm-hmm. It's simply that they have written down what they needed to know. So I have, from reading many grimoires, put together most of the pieces. I mean, you can't expect magic to be complete after, 1,600 years of persecution, when the books were burned, the magicians were burned, everything was done by the church to suppress this knowledge. So I got together what I could. I did the same thing for the Greco-Egyptian papyri, because there are thousands of different spells in there, and many of them are incomplete. Figured out which ones are the similar ones, boiled it all down to about 60 techniques, and then assembled the pieces of the techniques from across many, many papyri.
And would you?
So yes,
would you do the operation yourself to test it, Dr. Skinner?
Yes, definitely.
Okay.
A number of grimoires I've tested, and it hasn't worked. But then the more solid ones, the ones that have been fairly well documented, they will work. Amongst the Greco-Egyptian ones, there are some which don't appear to work. Well, they don't work for me at all. But the ones that do work are very effective.
And just so, all right, so I want everybody to know, and I want you to correct me too if I'm wrong about this, just for the beginners and magic in the audience, the grimoires are pretty much manuscripts written by old, I would say Renaissance magicians, but magicians of old. How far back have you? What do you think's the oldest one that you've translated?
Well, they go back to about the 6th century, but the oldest one that I've worked on is 1225.
Wow.
Which is a book that I have just produced called The Ars Notoria. And it is that's quite a fascinating manuscript. It's kept in Yale University, so I had access to it. And it's written in very minute but very beautifully written ecclesiastical Latin. And it's a grimoire which... is not interested in calling spirits, but it's interested in making the person who works it able to learn whole subjects in short periods of time, somewhere between 1 and 3 months, which I thought was a fabulously useful grimoire. So I spent a long time looking for different varieties of the different variations on that. And I published 5 different sets of illustrations in those grimoires, plus a commentary and explanation. But I will be bringing out a second volume, which will have the complete system when I've assembled it. I've experimented a little bit with this and had some very amazing results, but I haven't worked it sufficiently to be completely satisfied myself.
Now, I think what a lot of people are thinking right now too is, well, if you're working with these spirits, what we're taught, okay, and this is just a hearsay, I know it's what everybody says, but what we're taught is that when we work with spirits, we try to call upon things like that for our own, quote, selfish reasons, that we're going to get payback. Something's going to come back and bite us in the butt, right, because we've done this. What do you think about that? What would you say to that?
Well, yeah, I can be very precise about that. The person who I respect quite a lot, who who made an issue out of it. He referred to it as a slingshot effect, meaning you pull the slingshot back, and instead of it throwing the stone at your target, it flaps you in the face. And that does happen. So then you ask the question, well, why does it happen? And the reason why it happens is that when you have called a spirit and told it what you want, you have to bind it so that it doesn't, as it were, misbehave. Because they don't really like being here on the physical plane, and they're no particular brief for you. They're not very pro-human. So you have to bind them. Now, people who have experienced really nasty things afterwards, it's because they didn't bind the spirit properly. And some of those effects have been horrendous, and I don't know whether I should tell your listeners about some of the experiences of colleagues of mine, but one colleague, after calling up Paimon, actually failed to banish him properly, failed to bind him. And later the same night, a huge storm arose. And I have to say, this is not in an area famous for storms. It wasn't Storm Alley, which took 20 square meters of his roof off and threw it into the garden.
Oh, my God.
Now, anybody can say, okay, that was a coincidence. But I looked up the climatologic, because I trained originally as a geographer, so I looked up the original climatological statistics, and it appears that a storm of that strength had not happened in the last 500 years. So I would figure that there was a pretty conclusive argument that it was caused by, well, I hate to use the word supernatural, but that it was caused by the spirit. Paimon, incidentally, is one of the major kings, and it is very ill-advised to call him up. It's like if you're dealing with a government, you don't expect to call the president first up. You call the people further down the line, or in the case of magic, you call spirits further down the pecking order, further down the hierarchy.
Yeah, you don't want to go after the end boss, right? In a video game, you want to start out small.
Absolutely.
You want to start out small because you ain't going to last.
This guy, he had some experience, but he had not really understood that calling up one of the demon kings was a bad idea. So, as I said, you can dismiss it as a coincidence, but it was a very unlikely coincidence. Now, I can give you half a dozen other examples like that. But the bottom line is that these things happen because the binding wasn't done properly.
All right. Well, that makes a lot of sense, too. And so now you know, right? You know it's dangerous, and we're already up against our first break here. Look, we're probably going to get one shot at what we're doing now, right now, with Dr. Stephen Skinner. So what I'm telling you is if you've got a really important question about magic, you need to send it to me. You can send it via chat. You can text in. I don't know if I want to do the phone lines right now because I don't want to miss anything. So use the chat or the text in, and I'll cipher through them and pick out the best ones. We'll be right back with Dr. Stephen Skinner.
This is Corbin, son of the one and only Joe Root, and you're listening to The Fringe FM.
Did you know that qualified patients can access medical cannabis in all 50 states? Innocense is a medical cannabis collective that helps patients in all 50 states gain access to cannabis medication. Innocense does this with a streamlined process and strict compliance with the Compassionate Use Act of 1996, the Affordable Care Act, and the U.S. Constitution. It is important for each patient to understand the legalities involved, the costs, and the benefits of cannabis medication. Through truth, legalization, and education, the medical benefits of cannabis will supplant recreational perceptions and the real vision for change will be realized. Let the people and their personal doctors take control of their medical cannabis decisions before the greed of big business takes over. The tipping point for change is today, and CannaSense is ready to lead the charge and enable legal access for all qualified patients to medical cannabis through its proven system. For more information, go to thefringe.fm/care or click the banner on the website today.
I think by now we can get the information.
I love magic, and on Lighting the Void, each and every week, you will get to hear shows about magic, mysticism, and many other subjects that stretch your mind and imagination. So when I got my mind on the magic and the magic on my mind, I listened to Lighting the Void on the Fringe FM. It's magic.
May the gods look with favor upon you.
You're wondering what we're going to do to you, aren't you?
I'm getting older and noticing that my body just doesn't work as well as it used to. So I like to keep fit as possible by hitting the gym a few times a week. Recently, I started having a nagging bicep pain, and it got so bad I couldn't even lift the weights. When I was complaining about it to a friend, he told me about Angioprim. He said chelation helps remove toxins, heavy metals, and cholesterol in veins and arteries that may cause blockages. You know, after just 1 week of taking Angioprim, the pain was gone and now I'm back in the gym full strength. Scientific research proves the active ingredient in Angioprim has superior oral chelation action that helps promote cardiovascular health. So to learn more, go to angioprim.com. That's A-N-G-I-O-P-R-I-M.com. Or talk to a trained consultant. Call Angioprim toll free at 877-882-7221. You'll feel better with more energy. Call 877-882-7221 or go to the website angioprim.com.
The night is young, so turn up the heat with your host, Joe Root, on Lighting the Void on The Fringe FM.
Come, walk through the mossy creek and up the hill. Never mind the flashing lights and otherworldly shadows. They stay hidden within the trees. Come, step up to the shack and begin your journey to the answers that you seek. This is Lady Anne, and you are listening to Lighting the Void on The Fringe FM.
Okay, here we go. AncientLifeOil.com. AncientLifeOil.com. Now, this is for CBD. AncientLifeOil.com. Again, for CBD. Where do I get CBD? AncientLifeOil.com. It's pretty good stuff. Organic, non-GMO, we are the Ferrari of CBDs. AncientLifeOil.com. You know, they say when you mention a person's name three times when you first meet, that you're going to remember. So I'd say to you, nice to meet you, AncientLifeOil.com. It's AncientLifeOil.com, right? Nice to know that you help people. AncientLifeOil.com. Think about this. Occasional stress, occasional anxiety, occasional inflammation, occasional stiffness, and intruders that get you down. AncientLifeOil.com. Okay, so I'm going to give you a fact for the day. So Ancient Life Oil does not help you with business deals. Hold on a second. If you feel better, it could help you make a better decision. Okay, I'm wrong. Just remember to go to AncientLifeOil.com.
All right, everyone. This is Justin from the UK. Excuse the chitty-chitty. If you're into the Fringe and you want to hear the brass tacks, me old China plate, Joe Roop, and his guests on Lighting the Void will open your mince pies. You need to shut your north and south and use your 10-speed gears and listen to them bubble. You could hear a Barry Crocker, no Brussels, but he ain't no holy friar. Anyway, you beat a Barnaby Rudge and take a Butcher's.
Lighting the Void. The call-in number is 1-800-588-0335. If you would like to text, you can text in at 501-777-5631.
Well, I don't know about you, but to me, this is a very special night. Dr. Steven Skinner is here with us. I honestly believed that I would never get to talk to you. Gordon White told us all that you are the one, that your books are the ones that we need to get. And when I looked at them, like the magician's table, you know how you can peek inside, you can look at the books and stuff. And I thought, man, this is really, really advanced stuff here. This is real magic. And I thought, I'm never going to get to this stage. I'm never going to get to this stage of practicing this kind of magic because I'm having such a hard time. And I'm just going to be honest with my audience now because it's epic, like Stephen Skinner's here. So I always felt like I was never going to make it through the elemental grades because it's just so much work there. I thought it was like a school, like math class or something, right? You learn a subject and then you go do it. But there's just so much information that gets thrown at you and so many things you're required to do, daily adorations, daily ritual, daily study, nightly journaling, daily journaling, meditation exercises, you know, relaxation exercises. And I thought, this is probably, if I make it through this, one of the hardest things I've ever done in my entire life. And now I'm hearing from a lot of chaos magicians, well, you don't have to do it. You don't have to do it. And so I'm just curious. I have to ask you what your thought is on this. Is a structured initiatic path important? Do you think that's an important thing for everybody or not necessarily?
Okay, so you're really talking about Golden Dawn initiatic paths here. Yes, I belonged for a while to one of the spin-offs from the Golden Dawn. I think that the discipline is good. The fact that you finish up learning the names of angels and directions and things like that, that is always going to be helpful in magic. When I ran about, I think, 2006, I got a bit tired of just looking at Crowley 777 to check correspondences. So I sat down and did my own table of correspondences, which finished up with about 800 odd correspondences. And I published it as Complete Magician's Tables. So that will save a little bit of work if you get that. The whole initiatic path is good for you, but it's not essential to do magic. It's just like belief in spirits is not essential to do magic. It's like a friend of mine said, oh, can I be an atheist and do magic? And the answer is, yes, of course you can. But once you've done magic, you will no longer be a materialist. Once you see that there are other routes to getting things done rather than the physical routes, you will realize that there is out there a hierarchy of angels and spirits, and they will, given the right procedures, do things for you which are nothing short of miraculous. I'm not going to get personal and go through the many things that they provided me with, but I have to say they provided me with a very comfortable life. Other magicians like John King similarly had a lot of benefit from them. But magic is not woo-woo. Magic is not something you need to believe in. It's like surgery. You don't have to believe in anything. You just have to do it. And it takes work. Anybody who comes to magic hoping to solve all their problems, they come. I get a huge, as you can imagine, swag of emails every day, around about 200 emails a day, asking, can I help with this? Can I help with that? And basically, I don't have time is number one, but people should really do their own thing. Now, if the problems you have are fairly straightforward and materialistic, like having girlfriend problems or having money problems and such, you can use magic, but that's hard work. It's much easier to just use classical feng shui to change those problems.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. I don't mean, in the States, you don't have many practitioners of classical feng shui. You have an abridged system, black hat sect, which quite frankly doesn't work. But the original Chinese classical feng shui is quite good at fixing the everyday problems. If you don't want a miracle and you don't want something outside the normal run, you just want normal life conditions sorted out, then feng shui is quite easy to do. But again, there's a whole lot of waffle and books that will tell you nothing and waste your time. I hesitate to recommend my books, but I've got a book called Advanced Flying Star, which is not just advanced. It starts from the right at the bottom and works up through. And it will solve a lot of problems that people come to me and say, oh, can you do magic to fix this? And I say, no, you go away, learn that. Just one book full is enough, and you can do it, and quite effectively as well. So that's a plug for my other interests. I have two interests in life, magic and classical feng shui. I live in Singapore because they're both easily accessible here. Yeah, go on.
They run together well, though, right? I mean, I've heard other magicians say it's all about charge and energy. When I'm in the circle, I'm charging energy. Well, I guess so. I had a magician on here, or Thomas Sheridan was on here and told me that he split his house in half one time because he was charging up so much stuff. and he really did, you know. I looked into that, and his house did indeed split in half. And is that what it's all about? The flow of energy.
Yes, in feng shui, the energy is referred to as qi. In magic, it's also energy, but it's energy in the form of spirits. So who have a personality and identity, it's easier to work with. Feng shui is more impersonal. You can't split a house in two with feng shui. But it's like I said, if you want the miraculous, then you've got to look to magic. But if you just want everyday problems sorted, then quite often feng shui will do it.
Mojo's asking in the Fringe FM chat, Dr. Skinner, if you wanted to start practicing magic, where would you start? That's a tough question, because there's so many forms of magic, right? And you're talking to me about grimoire magic, but there's all kinds of different kinds of magic. I think, wouldn't you say that, I'm not trying to speak for you, but it depends on what you want to do?
Yeah, it does. It depends on what you want to do. Golden Dawn magic is good up to a point, but you know, Mathers, who founded the Golden Dawn along with Wynne Westcott and Woodman, he finished his work on the Golden Dawn. Then he went on and translated several of the Grimoires, the Sacred Magic of Abramelin the Mage is one that comes to mind, but he also transcribed the Key of Solomon. And the Key of Solomon is a really rock bottom basic good grimoire. There are even different varieties of that. I did a translation of three of them because there are many, many manuscripts of the Key of Solomon, 153 at last count. But between them, there's a system that works very, very clearly. So going back to your original question, where do you start? Well, like I said, you know, Golden Dawn is a good thing, but initiation is not necessary for magic. It's like, you know, belief is not necessary for magic. Initiation is not necessary. Initiation is a good thing in itself,
sure,
but it's not part of the requirements. So I would say if you're really starting right at the beginning, then you should look at my Techniques of High Magic, which I wrote with Francis King very many years ago, more like 40 or 50 years ago. That's a good eye-opener just to start with, and then move on from there to some of the grimoires I've translated, like the Goetia of Dr. Rudd. Then you can see, am I prepared to do all this work? Am I prepared to create a temple area? Am I prepared to paint the floor cloth? Am I prepared to do the consecration? Yeah. You have to consecrate the bits and pieces beforehand. Am I prepared to wait to a specific day and a specific hour? Am I prepared to memorize the ritual? Because that is not essential, but it's very useful. You don't want to be standing there in the half candlelight with a photocopy of the ritual in one hand, craning to look at it with your concentration all over the place. You want to memorize it, and then you just say it straight out. And then you can observe, and you can see if and when the spirit arrives by little clues like temperature changes, etc. So if you're prepared to do all that work, then the Goetia of Dr. Rudd is a good route. If you're a bit worried about dealing with spirits or demons, which are very much the same thing, and you prefer to work with angels, then there are a lot of angel books out there, but they're all, how do I say it, a little bit New Age. But in the Goetia of Dr. Rudd, the fourth book in there allows you to invoke angels from different chorus. So that's a good book to look at.
Okay. That's a good question from Dan Lopez in the Fringe FM chat. Says, which system would bring results quickly enough to feel progress that inspires devotion? Well, I'll let you answer that one first, for sure.
Well, it depends on what your attention span is. It took me about 4 or 5 months of preparation before I could comfortably and safely do a grimoire operation. Some grimoire operations, they require, you know, more or less 100% attention for that period of time. Some you can continue with in normal life. It depends on how quick a learner you are. There are other forms of magic which concentrate on psychological things, but they will only bring you psychological results. If you want exterior world results, then you've got to deal with what John Dee once called spiritual creatures, which was his sort of blanket term for angels, spirits, demons. Because poor old John Dee, when he invoked angels, quite often would get something else, like a spirit or an imp, turning up, pretending to be that angel. So I like his term, spiritual creatures. You know, Golden Dawn is a good grounding, but it won't bring you miraculous results. Initiation will is good for your soul, but it won't bring you miraculous results.
Yeah, I mean, there's a book that's not as extensive as that, too. I mean, by Donald Michael Craig, but it's you have one. I don't know. I can pretty much tell by the cover of it, and I've never read it, and I'm ashamed to myself that I haven't. So that's going to change. But do you start with something like opening of the Watchtower, so like Rigardi speaks of, things like that?
Yes, Ben, it's good to know how to do the vanishing rituals, the lesser pentagram and watchtowers, et cetera, et cetera. They are good surrounding material, good to start with, good to close with. But the real meat of the operation is the actual evocation in the middle. And for that, you need to know what are the words of power to use to command a particular spirit. You need to go through spirit registers to find the one that will do the job. Like, for example, a spirit who will bring a recalcitrant lover to heal will not be able to bring you gold. A spirit who can improve your position at work will not be able to do either of those other things. So you have to look through the tables of spirits and figure out the one that's appropriate. And then you have to do the work like drawing their seal up. There are no shortcuts. You can't just photostat the seal. You have to actually draw it. With the circle, it's no shortcuts. You can't just buy somebody's pre-made circle. You have got to paint it.
I always thought
so
that,
if you're prepared, if you yeah, I mean, it's sort of obvious that pre-made stuff doesn't really work. I'm sure that the guys who sell a lot of pre-made circles are frowning at this point in time. I'm sorry, guys, but everybody's got to make a buck. But people who want results have got to do the work. Also, you know, a lot of the names of spirits and angels are in Hebrew. So one of the benefits of the Golden Dawn system is it insists that you learn the Hebrew letters. There's only 22 of them plus another five. got to be able to do that. So you've got to be able to write them, and you've also got to be able to see them in your head when you're invoking, because you use everything you can. You invoke in a certain way, you voice in a certain way. You're using your memory, you're visualizing the spirit name, ideally in Hebrew. If you can't do that, you visualize it in English. Visualization is important. And you've got to do all these things. And once you've done them, suddenly it falls into place. Nothing actually goes click, but you can feel when you've got it right. And then when the spirit arrives, you can certainly feel that. If you work on a lot harder, then you will see that. And that's the first time I saw a spirit. I was pretty boggled, as it were.
I bet, yeah, because I've never seen a spirit, but I've had some things happen. I'll give you an example. A friend of mine, along with me, because we were both kind of going through the initiatic process together, just had the worst luck. And everybody that's listened to the show knows what I'm talking about. The power goes out, a flood, the internet goes down. And I'm not talking about this stuff is back to back to back. And I'm thinking, what's going on? I mean, is it a bad planetary alignment? Is somebody attacking me? You know, and I asked my friend, I said, did you read a book out loud or something? Like, did you invoke something? And they're like, oh, well, there's, you know, that book that had the Lucifer ritual in it. I said a few of the names while I was reading it out loud. And I'm like, what are you doing? Like, why are you doing that? You know? And I'm not saying that it was wrong or right. I don't know. That's what I'm asking you. Like, if we're reading a book and it's got the invocation names in it, why in the world would you read them out loud just to play around with it? That would cause a reaction, wouldn't it?
Exactly. The problem is, and it is a problem, they work. So if you're one of these people who have to memorize stuff by saying it out loud, you memorize it without the words of power. You just leave them out. Yes, I've had similar experiences to that. Once you've got it memorized, then you use it only in an area with a consecrated circle, etc. And then you called it, it arrives, you are protected. You can then ask it what you want. And then, most importantly, you can dismiss it afterwards. So there's a very short but effective dismissal ritual. There's a classic story about a Renaissance silversmith called Benvenuto Cellini. And he once hired a magician to do an evocation in the Colosseum. Anybody who's been to Rome will know that the Colosseum is like a huge amphitheater. In those days, obviously, you could wander in the middle of the night. Nowadays, you'd have the police immediately you tried. But anyway, he did the evocation, and instead of just calling one spirit, he just continued. And so eventually a whole crowd of spirits turned up. And then he got frightened and couldn't remember the dismissal ritual. And so they burned asafoetida. Asafoetida is a very nasty stench, which is designed to drive spirits away. And then they left. And on the walk home, they could see one or two of these spirits still on the rooftops of the houses they passed. Now, if you're a materialist, you say, okay, they'd inhaled too much incense and they were hallucinating. So that's possibly true. But I think it's because they failed to do the banishing on the way out. The thing about asafoetida is quite interesting. Spirits have a keen sense of smell. I mean, that sounds very odd because they don't have bodies. But they can smell and they can hear. So words for them have a real meaning. If you threaten them with the appropriate words, that actually is frightening to them. If you want to encourage them to come, you burn the right sort of incense. Sure, you can burn church incense, frankincense, but if you want a mercurial spirit, then you'll burn a mercurial incense. You want a Venusian spirit, you'd burn Venusian incense. When I say mercurial and Venus, I mean spirits under Mercury or under Venus.
Right.
Spirits have got a very rigid categorization hierarchy. And you burn things that are appealing to them, which makes the whole atmosphere much easier for them. Because for spirits manifesting on the physical plane, it's as tough as you and I diving underwater in a swimming pool. Sure, we can hold our breath for a certain amount of time, and we can look around and we can hear noises, but we just want to get back to the surface. So the spirits
right.
coming down to the physical plane, actually, in most cases, they just want to get out of there, which is why a very short banishing, permission to leave works, and they just go, thank God for that, and zip, they're gone. It's not necessary to banish them and use harsh words. But, so they have a sense of smell and they've got a sense of hearing. They're a bit short-sighted, and that has some implications, which we don't need to go into here. And they will turn up and just, or as it were, give notice of their presence. And that is really the easiest thing to do. You do that, and then you make sure you bind them to do the job you want them to do. And 9 times out of 10, it'll be done, and then you license them to leave, and they've left. So the things that people leave out and get wrong are they fail to consecrate the circle properly, they fail to bind the spirit, and they fail to license it to depart. And as a result of that, all sorts of bad things happen. Like one of my colleagues failed on one of those jobs. I don't really want to tell you all the personal details.
You give details, no, if you don't want to.
He lost his wife within a week. Oh. His children went sour on him. They weren't going to talk to him. He used to keep a pet python. It escaped. It's like you were saying, you can get an endless thing of bad luck one after another.
And everybody else tells you, man, it's just bad luck. It's just a phase. You'll go. But you know, you're the only one that knows. You know what's going on.
Like, yeah, you know what you did.
Yeah, right. Yeah, you know what's going on. And the thing is I don't know what's going on. Like, I was even watching this person's house through a camera, like Skype, like you and I are Skyping now. They always leave the lights on in their house, always. And the camera went dark. And I'm like, hey, I can't see anything. And they're like, what do you mean? I said, I can't see anything. They said, well, all the lights are on. I said, no, you turned them off. And they was like, no, I didn't. And then you could hear slamming and footsteps. And I'm like, what in the hell is going on?
He's got poltergeists as well. Spirits can interfere with electrical stuff. Long ago, I gave up trying to tape record rituals because they would just screw up the tape recorder almost every time. Or I'd go to play the tape back, and you can see how long ago this is. I'm talking about tape rather than disc or solid state. So that's as far back as I just gave up. I mean, it's like crop circles in England. You take cameras and phones into crop circles. If they're real crop circles, the electronics will screw up. You won't be able to take the picture. You tape record some notes. It never comes out, and so on. So I don't really know how they manage to do that, but spirits can mess up electrical stuff.
Are you finding, we're at the top of the hour, but I'll still ask this. Are you finding that you are spiritually, you're having a good spiritual life through your magical operations or any type of initiation or awareness increasing or anything just by doing grimoire work alone?
No, in a word. Just let me separate it. In English, the word spiritual and the word spirit sound as if they're connected, but just working in grimoires on spirits does not increase your spirituality. If you want to increase your spirituality, then go do yoga or go to church or whatever else. It's a separate thing altogether.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So the whole idea of the Golden Dawn.
Most people won't. Yeah, I mean, magic is a practical technology. You do stuff, it gets done. Changes happen in the exterior world. Changes don't happen in your psyche or in your heart. There are other procedures for fixing that. You know, there are a lot of Indian meditations and things. So if I wanted to improve that part of me, then I would not use magic. People who want to use magic to suddenly cure a mental problem or something can't be done. The spirits actually cannot mess with you mentally. They can't even read your mind. I know because Some of my friends are exorcists, Taoist exorcists in Taiwan. And they say, you know, you've got to really tell the spirits if you want them to know something. So what they do is, if they're going to exorcise somebody, and they have a long list of people coming in, they have to tell the spirits the full name and the birth date and the mother's name of this person for the spirit to actually latch on to what they're talking about. It's not sufficient just to wave a hand and say, this person here. So, and these guys do it every day, all day. So, you can invoke a spirit, you can be telling it one thing, and in your head you can be shouting obscenities at it, and it won't notice. They can't read your mind.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah, because I've always been taught that sometimes when you have a thought, you should take it up as an offering to either accept or reject, kind of like, and I've talked about it on the show, like a thought will come into your mind, and it could be a negative thought, it could be a thought based in fear. And if you accept it and you focus on it, then you'll spiral, you know, or you could just reject it immediately. And I've heard from a lot of people say, well, those aren't your thoughts. Those are psychic attacks from something else, right? Well, I don't know any, I honestly don't know anymore. You know, I think it's just the mind, you know?
Yeah. This mental stuff is quite different from the technology of magic. I find when I'm writing books, quite often sentences will pop into my head, which I immediately type down. That's all very helpful, but I don't attribute them to, or I don't know where they come from. I just assume that my subconscious is working harder than I am.
You know, DJ, and I do need to take a break. I'm going to, but DJ does make a good point that Dr. Skinner is definitely breaking down a lot of myths and misconceptions about magic, almost as if he's saying, you know, you can actually skip all that stuff if you want to get something done and learn how to properly do grimoire magic, and you can get stuff done. It's that simple, right? Yeah. Is that what you're saying?
Absolutely, without question.
Wow, yeah, fair enough. Yeah, see, that's the kind of honesty we like here on Lighting the Void, right? Even though it's still, I know for a fact, there's no doubt about it that it's scaring folks. But we'll be right back. Get your questions in. I will open the phone lines up as long as as long as everything stays kind of cool. It's 1-800-588-0335. We'll be right back with Dr. Stephen Skinner. Stay with us.
Listening to Lighting the Void Radio.
This is Crow 777, and you are listening to The Fringe FM.
Tea is the number one cleansing tea in America. We cleanse you with organic ingredients, and when used daily, you can increase your energy. Cleanse from intruders that set up camp in your colon. Cleanse your colon and feel the difference. Colon cleanses can be uncomfortable. Not Life Change Tea at GetTheTea.com. Life Change Tea is mild yet truly effective. Cleanse your insides every day. Easy to make, easy to use, and feel the results. Are you sold? Okay, then, here's how to order. Log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. Look for our specials on the front page. Get the Tea also carries top-rated supplements for those who care about their health, naturally. Again, log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. And feel the results. And for those of you that arm yourself with information, come to our webinar every other Monday at 5 p.m. Pacific time. That's every other Monday at 5 p.m. Pacific. You can sign up at GetTheTea.com.
I'm Ryan Gable, and I want to remind you to keep your radio, phone, tablet, or computer tuned to The Fringe FM. And visit the website, TheFringe.fm, to listen to the entire lineup of shows. You can also catch my broadcast, The Secret Teachings, Monday through Friday, beginning at 12 a.m. midnight U.S. Pacific Time, right here on The Fringe FM.
Alex.
Hi, I'm Alex Exum, and you're listening to The Fringe FM.
OMG! People are jumping on board to the Life Change Tea Regiment. Brew, steep, and drink for a gentle, taste-great cleanse. It's changing how they feel. See what everybody's talking about. Log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. Life Change Tea aids in digestive slowdown and helps people get moving down a healthy path. We won't make claims. We'll just let you decide. Experience is much better than a commercial anyway. If you want results, log on to GetTheTea.com and purchase your Super Strength Cleansing Tea. You won't be disappointed. And if you're looking for some mind-body suggestions, go to YouTube and punch in the search bar Health Matters Now. That's Health Matters Now. Put power into your health now. So, GetTheTea.com, that's GetTheTea.com for Super Strength Tea, and YouTube, Health Matters Now, that's Health Matters Now for valuable suggestions. GetTheTea.com, the tea that makes you go.
This is Reverend John M. Polk. Please visit me at johnpolkmedia.com and visit my show, Quantum Hologram Matrix, 5 p.m. Pacific, 8 p.m. Eastern, every Tuesday on TheFringe.fm.
Hey, Fringe FM listeners. Did you know that when you're on the road with limited data or no Wi-Fi available, you can still listen to every minute of the Fringe FM by calling 701-719-3971. No smartphone, app, or internet needed. Saves your data plan and no extra cost if you have unlimited minutes. Call 701-719-3971. That's 701-719-3971. Listen to the Fringe FM on any phone, anytime, anywhere.
Hey, is that a new music app?
Yeah, check it out, Surfer Music Discovery. It links to thousands of online stations, but the twist is you see the song names and artists that are now playing live.
That's different. No guessing. Looks like a waterfall of music.
So many formats. Rock, oldies, country, R&B, jazz, and a whole lot more.
How's that spelled?
Surfer. S-U-R-F-R.
Is it expensive?
It's free. No need to sign up or sign in.
Get the Surfer Music app free from Google Play or the App Store.
Hola, Fringe listeners. This is Dave Cruz of Beyond the Strange, and you're listening to The Fringe FM.
Stephen Skinner is here with us on Lighting the Void. Yeah, this is pretty epic for me. I'm glad I'm ending the week this way. So let's talk about this, because I don't want to just pick your brain to death with tons and tons and tons of questions that you probably do answer in your book. So since you are spending time with us, I'd like to ask you about your newest book, The Ars Notoria. You had mentioned it earlier, I believe, about... Is it work so you could learn things faster? I don't want to speak for you. Tell me what this okay. What this grimoire is about.
Right. So this is a really ancient grimoire. The edition, the manuscript I got the first information from, was actually written by a monk in 1225. And it was written because monks had to learn long prayers and various other things. And so they devised or they got... a system to learn things rapidly by magic. Now, before everybody goes off to get the book, it's not quite that simple. You have to work at it pretty much full time for about 3 months. And during that time, you have to also read the things you want to learn. But inside of that time, you can probably learn and absorb the whole of arithmetic or the whole of geometry or the whole of Latin. The subjects that it's lined up for are only the ones that were popular in the Middle Ages, so you can't learn the whole of computing or the whole of hacking or whatever else. It's really fairly dated. And when I translated the relevant bits of the manuscript and decided to publish it, I think my publisher must have been a bit dubious because I decided to entitle it in Latin. Not very popular these days. So the title is Ars Notoria. And their first reaction was, oh, it must be the notorious art. And in fact, it's not. It's the art of note. Now, let me just stand back from there and say, what does it do? Well, it gives you a procedure whereby you say a prayer and then you read out the names of various spirits and angels, one after the other, very clearly and slowly. And at the same time, you look at very complicated diagrams and just run your eyes backwards and forwards over these diagrams. And after working at it for about 3 months, at the same time you read the subject you want to absorb, your memory is improved and you absorb the subject much faster. So that's the claim of this particular grimoire. And so I was fascinated by the note, which are like illustrations that I'd never seen anywhere else. They're not like the normal sigils that you see in grimoires. They're not like anything else, but they were consistently drawn from one century to the next. People took a lot of pains to make them exactly accurate, and those are the key to the system. So I got together 5 manuscripts with particularly beautiful note and reproduce them in this book, along with a translation and an explanation. I hope to make a better explanation later after I've practiced with the book more. I have to admit I've only done a few short experiments with it, but I can say that of those few short experiments, one or two were remarkably effective. So let me give you an example.
Okay.
In this part of the world, people will speak Bahasa or and a bit of English and sometimes a bit of Chinese, but they have absolutely no contact with Latin. So I thought it'd be fun to see if somebody here could just learn Latin very rapidly. And so under the pretense of just showing them these illustrations and asking them to read out the prayer and read out the list of angelic and spirit names several times, I suddenly realized that this person was actually reading aloud the Latin. Uh-huh. And after another couple of days, she was able to pick out these Latin phrases and things in other texts. And we went on from there. So in the end, she was actually helping me with the text. So for somebody completely from a different culture to learn Latin in a few weeks in the end was pretty remarkable. So that was one of my little experiments, and I did a few of myself as well. But I need to work more on it. But this is a completely unique grimoire, and so this is my latest, and it's distributed by Llewellyn in America, but it's printed and published by Golden Horde in Singapore. So although the book is printed, the copies are still sitting in a ship somewhere in the middle of the Pacific making their way to San Francisco.
That's really cool because so that, it's never been printed in complete form before, right?
It's never been printed with the note because without the note, it just doesn't work. You can't just read the thing. You've got to look at these amazing illustrations at the same time. So this is the first time ever in history that the note have been printed along with the text and so forth. So I thought it was something well worthwhile doing, and people seem to have had quite a good reaction. So I was surprised because I thought the Latin title would put everybody off, but apparently it hasn't.
No.
So that's my latest effort. And I thought this one is more practical. It doesn't involve calling up spirits, but it does involve real changes. And everybody can do with having their memory improved. Because there's never enough, I find there's never enough time to memorize everything I need. My solution is to have a big library rather than the big head. But it would be fun if I could remember it all.
Do you have a humanitarian purpose for that? I get the sense that it's really not about, like you just said, I get the sense it's not about ego. It's about leaving this stuff. I mean, do you have are you doing this for anybody other than yourself? And what I mean by that is, do you think this is going to help humanity, or just are you doing it for the practice of magicians of the future? Do you have any grand reasons why you write these books and do this hard work to get a lot of these grimoires out that we've never had?
Well, I suppose my main reason is these have been so heavily suppressed and so frequently burned that if the present rate of destruction continues as it did in the 16th, 17th, and 18th century, this knowledge will be lost permanently. So my plan is to put the most important grimoires into print. And then once they're in print, they're distributed amongst many, many people across the world, so that whatever happens, there will always that knowledge will be preserved. But when the knowledge is just in one manuscript, you've only got to have the library burned down or somebody steal the manuscript, or just get to the point where nobody can read it anymore, because there aren't very many people who can read Latin now. Fortunately, I did it at school. I really hated it at school. I wish somebody had told me at the time that I would finish up absolutely needing this knowledge. But anyway, that's another thing. So first thing was to preserve the knowledge. I hated the idea that so much of it had been destroyed. Secondly, I wanted to do it for myself. So when I first decided to do to experiment with magic, I needed the text. So I needed to produce them in a form I could read rather than in a crabbed manuscript. And then my third objective is to make it available to other people. Now, for a little while, I was worried that making some of these things available to other people perhaps wasn't terribly wise, because you can actually do fairly dangerous things with magic if you do it properly. But then the same is true of owning a rifle or making an atomic bomb. You can kill a lot of people. You can do bad things. And I figure I'm not anybody's moral guardian, so I would provide the information, and what happens, happens. I mean, Aleister Crowley had a view at one stage that all drugs should be freely available because the stupid would kill themselves fairly soon. That would be good for the race. But he was a hard-headed old cynic, wasn't he, old Crow?
Yeah, he had his own drug problems too, though, you know.
Yes, so. And he never actually broke it right through to the end of his life. He was still a heroin addict. And I figure if Crowley, with the sort of willpower Crowley had, couldn't kick the habit, that certainly isn't a habit I ever wanted to acquire. I'm a child of the 60s, so I lived through the hippie era, and so you could guess that I have acquaintance with lighter...
psychedelics?
Yeah, lighter psych. Thank you, psychedelics.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, I love real hippies. The original hippies are the best ones, you know. We've got one that comes on the program frequently. He calls himself Randy. He calls in and says that he's mad because the original hippies gave up. He said, we had something going and we gave up, is what he said.
Yeah, yeah. They all drifted into the countryside to form, cohabiting farms, whatever. Or they moved into the Silicon Valley and became, you know, like the founders of Apple, who were pretty hippie originally. And it's such a pity because it was a great movement.
Mm-hmm.
I have to say, I was responsible for publishing two of the hippie newspapers in Australia. So,
fantastic.
Which have disappeared without trace, but at the time it was great fun to do. And again, it was a question of making information available, and then what people do with it, well, that is on their head or their karma, depending on what way they think. At least I've made it available. And I think that's quite the opposite from the attitude of some governments, no names, no pack drill, and some churches which just want to destroy this knowledge. If it works, let's keep it. Let's look at it. Let's use it. Let's expand it.
Absolutely. I believe that too. I also believe, and I can't prove it, but maybe I'm a bit of a conspiracy theorist. Some of these techniques are used in positions of power. I mean, there's no question that a lot of these powerful folks have their own private astrologers they pay big money to tell them when to do stuff. And, you know, so maybe they have their own magicians, I'm sure, that they call upon. And when Gordon, I want to tell you guys, too, that I learned something during the break. When Gordon White came on here and said, where I'm from, that there are people that all over the place that you can pay. People get paid, and they'll do anything to anybody because they got paid. That's their job as a magician. That is actually that happens, and not so much here in the West, but where they're from, it does. You know, so treat people right. That's all I got to say.
Yes. Well, in the West, you can't set up shop really as a jobbing magician. You can do a few jobs for your friends, but where I am in Singapore and just north of here in Johor. There are professional magicians, they call them BOMOs, and they will put up their shingle, their brass plate, just like other professions. So there's one down a road from where I used to live. The guy next door to him was a dentist, and he had a Dr. Gigi plate up, and then he had his plate up, and his credentials as a magician were in three different languages, in Chinese, Bahasa, and then a set of grimoire sigils under that, which I could read, but I'm not sure very many other people would know. So I knew he was pretty genuine. And then the next shop to that was a mini supermarket. So it was just ordinary life, and people would go to him. And because the communities here are very closely knit, if he screwed up and didn't deliver the goods, everybody would know very rapidly. And I got to know him, and I said, look, do you have many people coming back and complaining? He says, no, happens sometimes. And when it does, I have another go, and it then pans out. But if you told somebody, I'm setting up as a magician in London or New York or Los Angeles, well, you might get some curiosity, but I don't think you could actually make a living. These guys make a living, some quite well. The feng shui guys out here, and I know a lot of them, they charge big money for their advice. You know, $15,000 is not an unusual fee.
Okay.
But, you know, and some of them offer the deal, if you get what you want, you pay me. And if you don't, we scrub it. And if the deal is you want your whole life turned around, you want the woman you love to come and join you, you want to be rich again, that's a pretty good deal for $15,000.
Right.
I think so.
Yeah, it is.
Some of the big feng shui masters out here, and I'm not going to name them, but there's one had the job of fixing a large mall. And shopping malls are a big investment by somebody. And they had a falling footfall, I think that's what they call the number of people who come through the front door. And they tried everything, advertising, bringing celebrities, bands, whatever else. It didn't work. So they came and asked this guy, and he quoted them $100,000. But he quoted them in such a way, he said, if you do not have, I think it was a 40% increase in footfall in the next, whatever it was, 2 months or something, I will pay you $100,000. But if you do have it, you pay me. So they took him on because they thought, how can we lose? If they've got that increase in footfall, then they've easily got the money. So he did the job, and it worked, fortunately for him. And I asked him, you know, weren't you taking a bit of a risk there? And he said, no, it was a very obvious case what was wrong with their feng shui. I fixed it. And so after that, the chi energy was flowing through the front door, and it was bringing the people with it. Job done. So he actually also did a little bit of magic as well as feng shui, but that's neither here nor there. So out here, feng shui masters are respected, and magicians not respected as much, but still respected.
Really? Okay.
And all of the dattos in Malaysia, dattos local for Lord, will usually have a tame feng shui master. one of the feng shui masters in Hong Kong, he used to only work on retainer. He would say, I'm not going to charge you a fee for this job. You pay me X amount every year without fail, and then you call upon me whenever you have a problem and I will fix it. And he died very rich. He was the guy who actually trained me in feng shui initially in Hong Kong. And so he left millions to his sons, who were not interested in feng shui at all, but he left me the Qing dynasty manuals that had his knowledge in them. So I was well pleased with that. So in fact, that's where I got my start in feng shui.
We've got one more segment here after this with you, and I want to talk more about feng shui, but there's this one question I saw in chat that really did intrigue me before we take our break here, and it was, because you've done so much magic and you've translated so many things, I am curious too, what was the first operation, the first thing that you did, that you performed, that you experimented with when it came to grimoires?
Well, that's quite a memory. I got to university at 16, and in the same year, I did my first grimoire operation. And I set it up, and I did the proper circle, and I was a very conscientious lad. I was going to do everything right. I memorized the thing. I did it, and I got a visible appearance. And it scared the shit out of me.
I bet.
Because it was about the size of an orange, and it was bright, bright, bright orangey yellow, and it was a head. And its teeth were gnashing all the time, and it was looking at me.
Oh, man.
I thought, oh, shit. and I just, you're dismissed, banish, go, get the hell out of here. I thought, okay, I've cured any skepticism I had. But I just didn't want to deal with that for the moment. So
but
then
you
I
couldn't
went
stop
away
thinking
and,
about it, though, could you? After a, I would no, not have no, been able to I stop still, thinking about it.
Yeah, I still remember it extremely clearly. That was a shock as a first-time thing. So I figured that, okay, I can do this, and I know it's real. All I need to do is refine my technique. And so the next time, I took another 6 months to check everything, refine it. The next time was much more organized and calm and worked. So, I don't normally tell people about that tale, but it's
that's
certainly
pretty cool.
Freaked me.
Yeah, and that would freak me out, too.
That was the first time.
Gnashing teeth, I would make sure I'm not dreaming, but yeah, gnashing teeth was the first one. Yeah, that was cool. Thanks for the question in the chat. Look, we'll be right back with Stephen Skinner. We'll ask some more of your questions. When we come back, I want to talk a little bit more about feng shui and its properties and what it really does for you. Because we're talking to the right person here about that. After all, we did bring it to the West. So we'll be right back.
This is Dave Cruz, host of Beyond the Strange Radio, and you're listening to KTLK, The Fringe FM.
Listen, I want to tell you about GI Joy from GetTheTea.com. It's the best alchemical concoction of goodies for your stomach and digestive system I can recommend, and that's all based on my experience. Packed with colostrum, acidophilus, aloe, peppermint, and turmeric. If you do your own research, then you know this is the bee's knees for the stomach and digestion. Now, due to Big Brother's ears and the eye in the sky, you know I can't go into the details about what it helped me with. All I can say is, I got relief. It's non-GMO, no fillers, no preservatives, manufactured right here in the US of A, and delivered to you by the only people who stay on top of the game and are out in front. Go grab a bottle of GI Joy at GetTheTea.com and see what all the fuss is about. Again, that's GetTheTea.com.
Ready to open your mind? It's Lighting the Void with your host, Joe Roop.
The Fringe FM isn't just a radio station. We also provide services for all your audio production needs. If you're interested in live radio or pre-recorded podcasts, we're here to help. We even do audio enhancements and voiceovers if needed. If you want to do a podcast or live radio show, and even want the option to syndicate on terrestrial radio, from simple audio file enhancement to live production and call screening, we have you covered. We have worked with some of the best professionals in the business in order to provide coaching instruction for content creation, show structure, and more. Contact The Fringe Digital Media for more at info@thefringe.fm. That's info@thefringe.fm. Or call 501-777-5631 for a consultation.
Introducing Shadow Light Tarot from Waking Canvas, the Fringe FM's new contributing artist, Eric Tesey. This hand-illustrated black and white self-published deck serves as a reinvention of the tarot never before witnessed. Each of the several suits of this 88-card deck lineup form an infinite panoramic scene. Even the included visual companion guidebook is entirely hand-illustrated, cover to cover, with beautiful visuals and esoteric symbols and artwork. The newly released deck comes in a custom magnetic box with its own travel pouch. The Shadow Light Tarot Premium Deck and its travel size mini deck, Wonder Light Tarot, are both available now from WakingCanvas.com. If you use the code word FRINGE, that's F-R-I-N-G-E, at checkout, you'll receive an extra 10% off your entire order. To discover more, including a free reading and time lapses of all the illustrated artwork, make your way over to WakingCanvas.com today. That's WakingCanvas.com.
Hello, this is Vance Nesbitt. Take the time to expand your mind by listening to Lighting the Void with Joe Roop, right here on The Fringe FM.
If you are interested in occult subjects, psychic abilities, symbols, tarot, witchcraft, magic, or anything similarly related, my book Occult Arcana will provide you with a truly objective overview of these topics and more. Written in anything but modern language, Occult Arcana was compiled to help researchers balance their quest for a better understanding of the meanings of and in such studies. Occult Arcana is available in softcover and digital form from www.thesecretteachings.info. All copies can also be autographed if requested. That's Occult Arcana from www.thesecretteachings.info.
Somewhere between abnormal and paranormal, there's a show called Into the Paranormal. I'm Jeremy Scott. Hear me live Saturdays at 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 Eastern on The Fringe FM.
Feng Shui really works, we're talking to the right guy. Dr. Stephen Skinner is with us, and we did just get through talking about his book Ars Notoria, and it's you can go actually see the book at Golden Horde. I believe it's goldenhorde.net. Is that right, Dr. Skinner? Goldenhorde.net.
Yep, correct.
And then sskinner.com as well, and grab the book. But yeah, I am. I do want to talk about Feng Shui a little bit, because you'd mentioned earlier in the broadcast that We have a different type of feng shui here that we practice. It's called something. Yep. What, black sect? Is that what you call it?
We can get into that.
Yeah.
So just before we get out of magic, just let me tell you also that the book Ars Notoria is available on Amazon, and in America, it's published in Asia. In America, it's distributed through Llewellyn. So you can either go to the two websites that were mentioned, or you can go to Amazon and pre-book it or whatever. Okay, now flipping the switch back to feng shui. Yes, I brought feng shui to the West back in 1976. There had been no books on the subject written in English. There were plenty of books in Chinese. So I wrote the first one in English, and very gradually people became aware of it. But one guy in Los Angeles, Thomas Lin Jung, decided to teach it in America. And I have this from his own lips because I spoke to him about it. He said he found that Americans were not very good at using the compass. I find that hard to believe, but apparently he'd had students who couldn't understand why, if you turn the compass around, the south pointing is in a different direction. So he decided to simplify it, and he came up with a new rule. And the new rule was, find the front door, and that direction is north. So, as you can imagine, one time in eight, his feng shui would have been correct when the door actually did face north. But on the other seven out of eight times when it faced one other direction, northwest, northeast, etc., the feng shui would not have been correct. And he marketed this as black sect feng shui, or even originally black hat sect feng shui, implying that it was a sort of Tibetan practice. But in fact, it's not Tibetan. It's purely Chinese. It's been practiced in China from about 200 BC till about 1927. And why do I say 1927? Well, in 1927, feng shui was banned in China mainland. And so most of the feng shui experts left, and they went to either Hong Kong or Taiwan or Singapore. So one of the reasons I live in Singapore is that there's a lot of feng shui masters who live here, where they can practice feng shui in a much more open environment than in mainland China. Because, of course, the communist regime decided that anything that was religious had to be expunged. Now, feng shui is not actually religious. Feng shui is a technique. But because it had links with Taoist religion, they wanted to suppress it. And it's still, in fact, banned in China, although I have attended some feng shui conventions and conferences in Shanghai, at one of which, 3 or 4 years ago, I was elevated to Grand Master of Feng Shui, making me the only Westerner with that title. So I was very grateful for that. But it was sort of acknowledgement that I'd done the work. And I do read Chinese, and I had translated a lot of stuff, 3 or 4 classics from Chinese, and also worked out and interpreted all the rings on the Lopan. Now, the feng shui relies upon magnetic directions, and so the Chinese invented a compass actually long before it arrived in the West, long before even the Arabs had compasses. And they used the compass on land rather than on sea. And the compass acquired a number of extra rings. And the net result is a very beautiful instrument called a lopan. And from a lopan, if you orientate it correctly with the house you're dealing with, you can then read off various things which tell you what is going on in the house and outside the house. And this gives you the ability to make changes. So one of my colleagues in the business said, whenever he's asked, oh, what is feng shui? He always says, it's luck engineering. Now, luck means different things to different people. To most Westerners, luck means, will I win the lottery next week? And that is not luck. That is a calculatable chance. Winning the lottery in England, for example, is a 1 in 14 million chance. Luck for the Chinese is a sort of quantifiable thing, a thing that you can build up and accumulate, or a thing you can disperse and lose. And feng shui deals with both of those things, so that certain houses facing in certain directions will accumulate more luck and others will lose their luck. And so you quite often get the phenomena where people, successive tenants in a house, all have a bad time. Now, these things can be changed by certain feng shui changes, which is where feng shui masters make their money, by making those changes. And again, it's a technology. I'm not interested in religious stuff. I'm interested in things that work, and work according to the rules. Once I've established the rules, then from there you can just go on confidently. So out here, a feng shui master is a profession. These guys earn a lot of money. It's not uncommon to see a fee of, say, $15,000. Now, out there, you guys are thinking, $15,000? What? So I know that in America, typical fees are $100 or $200. The guys that pay $15,000 out here are solid Chinese businessmen with their heads screwed on. Because if they can make a quantum leap difference in a business, so it goes from making a loss to making a solid profit, or in their family life, so that they can acquire a beautiful wife and correspondingly beautiful children, then as far as they're concerned, it's worth the money. Feng Shui masters here earn a lot of money. The senior ones, none of them have less than $1 million in the bank. And they work hard for it, and good for them. But you don't make that sort of money by just bullshitting. You can perhaps make a certain amount of money by bullshitting. They have to have results. And as I mentioned before, in Asia, the word gets out. If you don't do the job properly, your neighbors and your friends will all get to know. In the West, everybody can sit in a little bubble, and of course Facebook outs some people, but...
Yeah, it's so not, that, it's not that how really it works then, right? If I asked you or I hired you and you did whatever you needed to do, which I'll ask you about, I don't want to get too detailed, and all of a sudden my life changed and I started having real good luck, and I'm talking about big time luck, and never, you know, where you have your friends going, geez, man, you're lucky, like that kind of luck, then people are going to know about it. Word of mouth is going to spread, and somebody's going to say, you know what? I hired this guy to change my environment and change everything, and this really works. That's how it works, right? I mean, I'm sure word of mouth spreads, and that's it.
Indeed. Otherwise, these guys couldn't charge the sort of fees that they do. I mean, for just a simple house job, I might charge $888, but that's for really basic, simple. If it's a business or something, it'd be a lot more than that. And I don't have very many people coming back for a refund. In fact, hardly any these days. So it works. And as for what you're doing, the whole thing devolves on the idea of qi, which is an energy which comes into the house, mostly through the front door, and circulates in the house. It accumulates and goes stagnant in some rooms, or it accumulates and becomes good in others. And even at the simplest level, like I had one job recently where the couple were living in a room which was beautiful, ensuite, nice view, balcony, everything. But they were having very bad luck because the qi was accumulating in a rather stagnant fashion there. Whereas one of their children, a much smaller room with an ensuite, but not nearly as nice, with very good qi. And I said to them simply, change rooms with your son. And they went, no, his room's not nearly as nice. I said, do you want it to work? And they said, yes. So I said, no, just change rooms. Sleep in his room, put him in your room for just a little while and see what happens. And what happened is their luck did turn around pretty 180 degrees, and they're very happy with that. In fact, okay, I'm going to tell you the story. How did I start in this? So I started in this because I had a Chinese barrister friend who was very westernized. And we used to flat share in London. And he'd been to Harvard and approached the bar in London, etc. And he hoped, a big shot lawyer. So he moved out to Hong Kong thinking he's basically Chinese. It will work for him. He went to Hong Kong and got an office, and nothing worked. He didn't get the clients. Of course, in those days in Hong Kong, it was who you know, not what you know. But he didn't know that. And he was just paying rent. And finally, he phoned me, and I was still in London. He said, it's not working for us. Can I come back to London. I said, well, no, you can't come back because you're now married. So I said, look, I'll come out to Hong Kong. So I did. And I knew a little bit about Chinese culture, so I just thought, I'll tease him. I said, hey, why don't you hire a feng shui man to fix your luck? And he looked at me and said, you've got to be joking. So I said, look, it can't hurt. So I grabbed his arm and I said, come on, we're going up Temple Street in Hong Kong. And we went up there. And in Temple Street, there are a lot of practitioners on the with little tables on the side of the street. I mean, they're of different quality. Some are good, some are not good. And we picked one likely lad. He was probably 40. And we hired him to come back to John's office. He came back to John's office, and he made some changes. So he told John, you got to move out of that big corner office with the view and the nice glass windows, and you got to move into this office. And he points to the photocopying room. And you got to close this door, and you got to put some new plants here, and so on and so forth. And then he did a report in Chinese, which was very thorough and accurate.
I'm sorry, we lost your connection there for a second. Dr. Skinner, what did you say he did in Chinese?
He did a report in Chinese and left it with us. So we had an argument after that. John said, I'm not moving into the photocopying room. I said, John, what does it matter? You don't have any clients to interview. What's it going to hurt? So he agreed, and he moved. And 10 days later, he got a big brief on the corruption trials that were happening in Hong Kong in those days, plenty of money attached to it, and he did that. And then he got other clients, and in a matter of months, he had more work than he could fit into the office, so he moved to another office. And I said, hey, John, use the same guy. So he did. And, well, the rest is history. Within a year, he became so famous that he was cartooned in the South China Morning Post, and the cartoonist didn't even need to say who it was because people could recognize his profile by then. And he went on to become very rich, and finally he retired, and now he's bored. But that's not important to this story. The importance of the story.
You just hinted to me about somebody famous, though, Dr. Skinner, didn't you? And you know who it is, and we can't know. Okay, I'm cool with that.
No. Sorry, you can't know. <All right. laughs> anyway, he went on to great success, etc. So I thought, wow, this is amazing. And because I was a geography lecturer at the time, and geography has a word very similar to feng shui in Chinese, di li. And I said to this guy, let's go and have a drink. And so he started drinking brandy in Wan Chai, which is the red light district. And late one night when he was completely drunk, he said, you know who I hate most in the whole world? I said, who? He said, Western architects. I go in, I tell them what they're supposed to do, and then they mess it all up and change all my recommendations. And they put the door where they want, they put the fountain where they want, and it doesn't work. And then it's bad for my reputation. So I said, okay, take me along to your next client meeting and let me, as a geographer, interface between you and the architect. So I did, and I said to the architect, give me a copy of your plans, and I penned on them the feng shui master's recommendations and handed it to the owner. And I said, that's what he should do. So he did, and it worked. So he was very happy with that. And I said, look, I'll do you a deal. I'll come to your client meetings, but you teach me the real feng shui from the bottom up. Which is where I got my first input and where I learned my feng shui. I've learned a lot more since then, but that was the beginning. So there you have it. So this guy went on, charged a lot bigger fees and so forth, and became rich. And I got his books when he died, and that had all the information I needed in them.
So literally we could study... what you've written about it would probably help and could possibly change our lives if we'd done this properly, is what you're saying. Yeah.
Yeah. Now I'll do my book plug. I've got a book out there called Advanced Flying Star Feng Shui. It's not advanced. It really starts with the simplest stuff. But it tells you how to do the feng shui on your house, on your apartment, on your ranch, whatever. and how to make the changes. And I recommend that you only make one change at a time and see what happens. Don't do it all at the same time. So you've got a clear idea of what's happening. You need to read the book through, think about it, and then you can do basic feng shui. And let me tell you, it's a lot easier than basic magic. And you can achieve quite practical, real-world results. If you need miracles and magical results, then you need magic. But if you just need real-world results, then proper classical feng shui is the right way to go. Ignore any of this black set feng shui because it just doesn't work.
No, well, they're guessing. Built a fine amount of money off guessing where north is. It's where your door is.
Yeah, exactly. It works in a psychological sense. You feel somebody's come and done something. You're told you've got to clean your clutter up. That's always a good move. You're told you've got to do this and you've got to do that and so forth. And so it puts you in a better head. And so you do get an improvement from it. So I can't disrespect it completely, but it is not classical feng shui. Classical feng shui is quite complicated. But basic flying star feng shui, anybody with a bit of time and patience can master enough to make changes in their own property. So that's my recommendation, advanced flying star feng shui.
So how does this correlate with, let's just say, the spirit world or spirit realms? Does it mess with it at all? Say if the energy is just bad, it's all out of whack.
It doesn't.
Okay.
What the energy, qi energy, correlates with? It's part of feng shui. It's part of Chinese medicine. It's part of kung fu. You could say that these more or less Chinese secrets have come to the West since the 1960s, a bit at a time. Back in the 60s of the Hippie Revolution, Buddhism came to America and the rest of the world. And then Tibetan Buddhism, and those are still going strong. And then Kung Fu came in with Bruce Lee, and everybody went, you can't break a brick with your hand, and he demonstrated indeed you could, and fairly easily. And why is he able to do that? And the answer is qi energy. He accumulates that in the edge of his hand, and he breaks the brick. So then acupuncture came to the West, and people went, you can't cure a headache by sticking a pin in your toe. And that also depends on qi energy. And there are lines of qi linking different parts of the body. And so remarkably, you can actually needle some even remote part of the body to cause cures. And now medicine, Western medicine, has accepted that you can do anesthesia with acupuncture. You can do various other things. It doesn't cure everything, but it cures a lot of things. Particularly musculoskeletal problems and back problems. So I can tell you that from personal experience.
Interesting.
But it relies upon qi flowing through the body. And the acupuncturist realigns the qi. If the qi has stagnated or the qi is not getting through to your left ankle, he realigns it and suddenly your left ankle is beginning to function as it always did before. And then with kung fu, the qi is directed against the opponent or the brick, and it breaks. You couldn't do that if you just hit it with your hand. You break your hand. And then the third thing that came through was feng shui. If you can align the qi inside of a house, suddenly it's like taking a deep breath. Lots of things become easy, which were screwed up before. So all of these use qi. Now, people say, well, you can't measure qi. Well, you can't. There's no way. Several Japanese scientists claim they can, but nobody can measure qi. It's like before the 16th century, nobody could measure blood flow. Hopefully, in another century's time, people will be able to measure qi. But at the moment, they can't. But the Chinese have figured out how to use it on bodies, how to use it in karate, how to use it in medicine, and how to use it in luck engineering. So all of these things, theory of qi, etc., comes from Taoism in China. And the Chinese have quite reluctant to let this information out. And since the communist regime, they're quite reluctant to have it practiced inside of China. But it works, but it does not connect with spirits and magic. That is a separate box.
So even if you've got a temple in your house, it doesn't affect it no matter where you put it, so to speak.
No, it's not going to affect the chi flow. You can put the temple in an area of good accumulating chi. That's fine. But personally, I'd sooner have my bedroom in the area of good chi and my study in the area of good chi, because those are functions where you spend a long time sitting or sleeping.
Right.
Feng Shui is not so important in areas where you're only there for a little period of time. Like, it's not important in hotels. You go into a hotel, you spend one night there, you're not going to be really affected by the chi in the hotel. But in your home, areas like sitting in front of the television, some people spend an awful lot of time doing that. Sleeping in bed, we all spend a lot of time doing that. Sitting at a desk, I spend a lot of time doing that. These are areas where you've got to improve the chi flow so you get better results. So wow. that's the rationale behind those three Chinese modalities and behind feng shui.
Yeah, and then you've got a few other books too on feng shui, right? The Living Earth Manual. I mean, you've got some other written material about it too, yeah, as well.
Yeah. Living Earth Manual was the first one I did, which I did back in 1976 after the events I just told you about, when I learned feng shui from this old master who didn't like architects. So I immediately, you know, I'm making notes and everything, and finally, and I had a huge folder of notes. I thought, hell, this could make a book. And I went and saw Routledge, Kegan, Paul, and they accepted it. And so that was the first time it had appeared. Now, some missionaries spoke about feng shui in the 1800s, but nobody wrote about feng shui in English in the 1900s until my book. And then after that, a few came out. Sarah Rushback's book came out. And now there's a huge number of books on feng shui out there. But most of them are on black sect feng shui and should, frankly, be ignored.
Well, I am so fascinated and intrigued by all of this, and I can't wait to learn it, because, I mean, I think this is life-changing stuff. Magic is life-changing in miraculous ways, especially if you're going to attempt grimoire magic. And then here's the guy that you need to learn it from. But I've learned quite a bit tonight. Feng Shui, that, you know, my thoughts about the Golden Dawn wasn't totally wrong, but there's some ideas that I might need to take another look at based on that. And then, you know, never hurts to feng shui up the house the right way, or where, or your place of worship or living. And I want to thank you so much for coming on the broadcast. I know you got to get out of here, and it's been a real pleasure talking to you. Absolute pleasure to be able to speak with you. And if one more time, if you can, before we roll out of here, please plug away your links one more time and where everyone can find your stuff, Dr. Skinner.
Well, thank you. I've enjoyed being here. I like intelligent questions. But, my stuff, books, I've done more than 45 books. But the key ones all appear on Amazon. And so for Magic, Techniques of High Magic, which I wrote with Francis King, and the Grimoire of Dr. Rudd, which is for practical stuff. And then on the feng shui side, Feng Shui, The Living Earth Manual is the first one. But if you want to actually do feng shui in your own house, then Advanced Flying Star Feng Shui is the book you should get. I won't bother mentioning all the others because it will just become a blur. But you can check the Wikipedia entry for Stephen Skinner, brackets author, and there's a full list on there for any of those who want to dig at that depth. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, you're very welcome. Thanks for coming on the broadcast. I really do appreciate it. And it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. I can't wait to dig into the books. I'm sure I'll be reading these books for quite some time. So it's been an absolute pleasure. It's been an honor to talk to you, actually, from somebody that studies the occult as well. So thank you for coming on the show.
Okay. Thanks again.
Thank you. Bye-bye. I never thought that I would get to talk to him. That's happened a few times on the show, actually. I get to speak to somebody that I've never thought I was going to get to talk to. So what I want to say to right now to you guys is because of the conference that's coming up and because of the blistering work I did to make sure that we got all of the archives out for you up to date, I'm running on no sleep. So for what I'm going to do once, just this one time only, for my own health, is we're going to end the show early. I'm going to put on a different show after this, and then Ryan Gable from Secret Teachings is coming up. Tomorrow night's going to be a best of, and we will be at the conference this weekend. And so that's exactly what we're going to do. I hope I'm not letting you down. It's only an hour. You won't miss me too much, but we'll be back next week. Thank you all for coming on the broadcast. Don't forget, do not copy this without written permission. Music was by Crone Oaks, guitar by Bundy. Also, I want to thank Pacho, Dr. Steven Skinner, for coming on. Pacho for helping me book this show. Don, Dennis, Lady Ann, Dan Lopez, Eric Markham, our program director, Jeremy Scott. We'll see you guys next week. Come to the conference if you're around, and tune in this weekend. We'll be broadcasting live. Good night.
On this program do not necessarily reflect those of the Fringe FM, KTLK Digital Broadcasting, its sponsors, affiliates, or staff. Listener discretion is advised. You're so warm inside. I was always a fool for my Johnny. For the one they call Johnny.